Listening Library presents Who Was Alfred Hitchcock? By Pam Pollack and Meg Belviso. Read for you by Gildart Jackson. Who Was Alfred Hitchcock? In the early 1900s, London, England, was a city full of crime. The officer on duty at the East End police station never knew who was going to come through the door, but one night, when the door opened, he was quite surprised by what he saw. It was a little boy, 5 or 6 years old. He was chubby and quiet and alone. His name was Alfred Hitchcock. With wide eyes, he approached the policeman and handed him a note. In later years, Alfred Hitchcock could not remember why he had been sent to the police station. He only knew that he had done something wrong at home. Perhaps he tracked mud through the house or didn't do his chores. Whatever it was, Alfred's father thought he needed to be taught a lesson about what happened when Alfred didn't behave. So he wrote a note and sent Alfred to the local police station. He told him to give the note to the officer on duty. Alfred watched, terrified, as the policeman read his father's note. Then the man took Alfred by the hand and led him into the station. For the first time in his life, Alfred saw a jail cell. It had a big lock and iron bars. The policeman put Alfred in the cell and shut the door. He turned the lock with a big metal key. Alfred gripped the bars with his tiny hands and pressed his round face against them. The policeman looked down at him. "This is what we do to naughty boys," he said solemnly. Then he walked away. The seconds ticked by. Alfred's heart was pounding. Would the man ever come back? Would Alfred be in jail forever? Would he live on bread and water? Would anyone come and save him? Just when Alfred was sure he would never see his mother again, the policeman returned. The child had only been in the jail cell for about 5 minutes, but it seemed like forever. The policeman opened the door and let Alfred out. He said he hoped the young boy had learned his lesson. Alfred certainly had. He would spend the rest of his life scaring movie audiences all over the world. When asked where he got his inspiration for such thrilling, scary stories, he always mentioned his time in jail. Was the story made up, or was it true? No one can say for sure. Alfred Hitchcock claimed it really happened, but Alfred Hitchcock was a master storyteller. Chapter 1. Call Me Hitch. Alfred Hitchcock was born on August the 13th, 1899. His brother William and sister Nellie were 9 and 7. Alfred's father, William, ran a grocery store, and his mother, Emma, took good care of the children. The family lived above the grocery store. Life at 517 High Road was very orderly. From an early age, Alfred liked to be alone. At family gatherings, he stood off in a corner, watching everyone else. Although there were other children who lived on his street, Alfred always played by himself or watched the other children play. For him, this was more fun than being with other people. By the time he was 8, Alfred had ridden all the tram lines in London. He had taken the river steamers all the way to the mouth of the Thames River. He loved to ride streetcars and big ships and kept charts of all their routes. He also memorized train timetables, the hours of all the arrivals and departures. To Alfred, keeping track of the schedules was as exciting as reading stories. Every evening, Alfred's mother called him to her room and asked him questions about his day. He confided in her about everything he had seen and heard. At the time, movie theaters did not exist, but the Hitchcock family loved to go to the theater to see plays performed on stage. Alfred not only enjoyed the stories and the characters, but also the way the lighting could make the audience react. He remembered a show where the ghostly-looking villain stood under a spooky green light. He was amazed at how a simple lighting trick made a character seem more frightening. It sometimes seemed as if much of young Alfred's life was scary, too. One night he woke up and found the house empty. He went from room to room calling out for his parents. He didn't know it, but they had gone for a walk. His brother and sister weren't at home. Alfred was completely alone, and he was scared. He wandered around the empty house. There was nothing but night all around him. Later, his parents came home and found him in the kitchen, crying. In 1910, Alfred started school at St. Ignatius College, a Catholic school for boys. Alfred still liked to spend time alone. Years later, a classmate of his remembered him as a plump schoolboy leaning against the wall, his hands folded across his round stomach, simply watching the other boys. The Jesuit priests who were his teachers were strict and punishments were harsh, and yet Alfred still broke the rules. One of his favourite tricks was to steal eggs from the school henhouse. He liked to throw them at the windows of one of the teachers' homes. When the teacher asked him who did it, Alfred looked at the sky and shrugged. "I don't know, Father. It looks like the birds have been flying overhead." This attitude earned him the nickname Cocky from the younger students. He hated the name almost as much as Fred. That was what his parents called him. So Alfred Hitchcock chose a nickname for himself, the one by which he would be known for the rest of his life, Hitch. By the time he was 14, one of Hitch's favourite pastimes was sitting in on criminal trials at the famous Old Bailey courthouse. He loved listening to the details of the court cases, especially murder trials. Whenever he could, he visited the Black Museum at Scotland Yard. The Black Museum. The Black Museum opened in 1874. Today, it is housed in Scotland Yard, the headquarters of the Metropolitan Police in London, and is officially called the Crime Museum. It houses items and evidence from famous and unusual crimes. It was created to help police officers study crime and criminal tactics. Today, police officers from all over the world visit the exhibits, which include a letter thought to be written by Jack the Ripper. The Crime Museum also contains nooses from executions, swords hidden in canes, guns hidden in umbrellas, and a collection of counterfeit money. Alfred attended St. Ignatius College until he was 14. Then his parents sent him to the School of Engineering and Navigation. They hoped he would become an engineer, but he was much more interested in the latest entertainment to hit England, movies. There were 400 movie screens in London by 1914, visited by 80,000 people weekly. That wasn't very much compared to the 5 million people who attended movies daily in the United States at that time. Movies hadn't quite caught on yet in England, but they had captured the attention of teenage Alfred Hitchcock. Chapter 2. The Director's Chair. Alfred's father, William, worked long hours in the grocery store. He had difficulty breathing and later developed problems with his kidneys. When Alfred was only 15, his father died. His brother, William Jr., no longer lived at home, and his sister was already married. Alfred left school and went to work to earn money for himself and his mother. Alfred also took photography and art classes at the University of London. He began reading film journals. These were not fan magazines that gushed over stars. They were technical journals that explained how movies were made. Hitch preferred American films to British ones. American movies used backlighting, placing some of the light source behind the actors, which made the actors appear to stand out from the background. In British films, everything looked flat. It wasn't so different from the lighting tricks he'd noticed on the stage as a young boy. In 1920, the American film company Paramount announced that it was building a studio in London called Famous Players Lasky. Alfred went to the office and showed them some of his drawings. He was given a job designing film title cards. At this time, there was no recorded sound, no audio track for movies. All movies were silent. Any important information or dialogue was provided in words shown on the screen called titles. Alfred did so well drawing titles that he became head of the title department. From there, he went to work in the editorial department, deciding what the titles should say. He studied American writers for tips on how to write scripts. When a director got sick, Hitch stepped in to help direct. He was learning all aspects of filmmaking. Paramount's famous Players Lasky stopped making movies in England in 1923. The studio was then rented to British-owned film companies. One was run by Michael Balkan, who gave Hitch, as Alfred was now known, a job as an assistant director. Balkan asked Hitch who he thought he should hire to write scripts. Hitch offered to do it himself. He also volunteered to be the art director. The one job he didn't take for himself was that of editor. For that, he recommended a young woman he had worked with in the past, Alma Revel. The more Hitch worked with Alma, the more he liked her. They took a trip to Germany to scout locations for a new film. On the way home, Alma became seasick crossing the English Channel. Hitch chose this moment to propose to her. According to Hitch, Alma groaned, nodded her head, and burped. He said, "It was one of my greatest scenes. A little weak on dialogue, perhaps, but beautifully staged and not overplayed." By 1925, Hitch was writing scripts, creating sets, and assisting the director. The only job he had never done on his own was the most important one, director. After years of learning nearly every job on a movie set, Alfred Hitchcock was finally ready to sit in the director's chair. Chapter 3. The Silent Era. Hitch's first completed movie as a director, The Pleasure Garden, was about two friends who have some unlikely adventures in love. Michael Balkan sent Hitchcock, along with Alma, to Germany in 1925. The cameraman warned Hitch not to tell the border patrol that he was carrying film or cameras. He would have to pay German customs officers a fee to bring them into the country. Hitch trembled and sweated as customs officials searched his train compartment. They didn't find the camera, but they took all the film. The next day, just as the cameraman arrived with £20 of new film, their original film was returned. They had paid for twice as much film as they needed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.